Ja. It is 7 o'clock, Pammy. You're not. Pam's not dressed like a sheep this week. She just has her blanket and two pairs or three pairs.
Three.
Three pairs of socks.
And some warm tea.
And some hot tea. It's hot tea, probably, isn't it?
It is.
Three pairs of socks. Two pairs of wool socks, right? Can you believe it? Anybody else out there like that? I see, I had to change shirts. I might even have to take my jacket off. That's making me hot thinking about it. You know, at church it's kind of weird because... I had to turn that off. At church, we... I know some people are cold, but you can only take, like, so many things off, right? You can take off your sweater, but the t-shirt... Pam won't let me wear one of those... what do you call them? The white muscle shirts. I don't even own one. My kids wouldn't let me wear one. But sometimes I do have to wear a t-shirt because...
Everybody out there is probably thanking me that I don't let you wear one.
Exactly. Some of us are just hot natured. Some are cold natured. I can name some people on here tonight that are just like that. Pammy gets cold easily. She has a blanket. And three pairs of socks. Well, grab your blankets, your socks, grab a Bible.
Your hot tea.
Your hot tea. We're going to be in John 12 tonight. Hope everybody's doing well. It's nice to see the blue skies, a little bit warmer temperatures. That helps everyone. Pammy and I got to go out and take a Sunday short drive. Still got to do one of my favorite hobbies, and that is just, I love photography, and just took my phone, and we... I love barns and big oak trees, so got to do that. So that was enjoyable. So get out, enjoy some weather tomorrow if you can. Listen to some good music. Anything that helps you out. So, well, hopefully the scripture, reading God's word, is food for your soul and gives you spiritual strength, wisdom, encouragement, conviction. In a good way, God's always right molding us and sanding off those rough edges and conforming us to be like Christ if we're believers. And if you're not a believer, we always pray that you would come to know Christ in a saving way, to know your sins are forgiven, get to have an eternal relationship with the God of the universe, and then get to know Him better. And so we're going to be in John 12. We're going to pick it up in... Verse 19, 20, we'll begin in prayer and then we'll jump right in. Lord, do give you thanks once again that we get to meet evening online to study your word together as people have their Bibles open, as we interact with the scripture. We thank you for all that you do on our behalf. We're thankful that we get to read your word and study it, and thank you that you are a God who's revealed yourself. You have not remained hidden. And as we enter into these holy days of the life of Jesus, this final week, we just pray that you might, as we interact with the text, just see how incredible you are to love us in this way. And bless each one that's on here tonight. Many needs, I'm sure. Different circumstances. We thank you for the body of Christ, and that we get to pray for one another and encourage one another. And we just thank you for this time in Christ's name. Amen. Can you hear me okay tonight? Good evening to all. Some people up all the way in Council Bluffs, Iowa. And some people here and in Hannibal and maybe Cedar Rapids. Pam has her phone on, so I won't be able to keep up with all of it tonight. Well, last week we saw Jesus entering into Jerusalem purposefully, setting out to fulfill Scripture. To make a point, which is going to ultimately lead to his death. And so we are now in Jerusalem. It is the Passover time. Thousands of people are there. And it's kind of interesting. We'll pick it up in verse 19. Some religious leaders, they're called Pharisees. said to one another, you see that you're not doing any good. Look, the whole world has gone after him. And what I like about this, the irony of John, is now there were some Greeks among those who were going up to worship at the feast. You may read that and not catch it. Largely, it's Jewish people that are going down to Jerusalem. The Mosaic Covenant, the Passover, all of that. Passover is to celebrate God's redemption of the Jewish people out of slavery, out of Egypt, redeeming them by his grace. And he gave this annual feast called the Passover, where they were to sacrifice a lamb, remembering what God had done for them and generations before. So at the time of Jesus, that's now been 1,400 years, and they're still celebrating it, looking back to that event. So what are Greeks doing there? Well, many people in that culture, Jews were spread out around the known world at the time. And just as today, people are interested in other, quote, religions. Evidently, there are some, they're called God-fearers, people who are not Jewish, but they want to follow Judaism. Or there could be a large number of them. They're still checking it out. Just as today, or if you're in another country, you might have people from a different religious background be checking Christianity out. We believe in dialogue with people, no matter what background, because we do believe Jesus is the long-awaited Messiah who died and rose again, and eternal life depends on him. But his fame, no doubt, has spread. The signs that he has done, his teaching. And so now you have some Greeks who, and the reason we know that they're seeking out Judaism is because it says some Greeks among those who were going up to worship at the feast. But no doubt as they're going up to worship, they've heard of Jesus. And notice, says these men came to Philip, who was from Bethsaida of Galilee, and began to ask him, saying, "Sir, we wish to see Jesus." So Philip came and told Andrew, and Andrew and Philip came and told Jesus. And what's interesting, you might ask a question like, why did they ask Philip? Why were they asking Philip?
Well, probably just like a celebrity, you can't get to him, so you get to one of his supporters.
So it could be, it's just that Philip is there. Could be. Philip is really versed in Greek. He comes from the Upper Galilee region. A lot of Greek-speaking Gentiles even in that area. The text really doesn't say, but they're asking, inquiring about Jesus. And so they came and told Jesus. We don't really know much beyond that. Why did they seek? Could just be, hey, they see that Jesus is nearby or heard that he's nearby, ask some of his followers.
But then why did Philip have to tell Andrew instead of just going directly to Jesus?
Well, it says then Andrew and Philip told Jesus. You know, it'd be like you and I, hey, you know, somebody's saying, hey, this is what these people are asking. What do you think we ought to do? Let's go tell Jesus that some people want to see him.
Okay, gotcha.
But beyond that, not much there. But throughout the Gospels, what's the purpose of the apostles? To be fishers of men, right? They are to always be looking, just like we are, as I said Sunday, looking for ways to what? Bring people to Jesus, right? That's ultimately what we're called to do. Everybody that's on here that's a believer, been given the mandate. If you're at church Sunday, that's largely what I talked about. Jesus is giving us the task to share the good news with everyone. And thankfully, we're able to raise, I think, really good support this year to send money for international missionaries. We take up a special offering, Christmas offering, called Lottie Moon. She was a missionary in China. Because if we can't go to the nations, so the Greeks are not Jewish, they're outside, and Jesus's mandate after he was raised from the dead is to go into all the what?
World.
All the world, all the nations. And so we're going to talk about that a little bit later. Jesus comes as the Jewish Messiah, but the ultimate goal is to reach people of every tribe, tongue, and nation. So these Greeks are coming to him. And Jesus, in verse 23, answered, saying, "The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified." Now, let me ask you tonight, if you're on, why is this verse important, if you've been with us?
Because he's been saying all along, "My hour has not yet come."
Yeah.
And that what has.
Beginning in John 2, right? tells his mother, my hour hasn't come yet. I've got, let's just turn over a few chapters back. Turn over to chapter 7. So why is it important that Jesus says the hour has come? Because in chapter 7, verse 30, Jesus had made some religious leaders upset. He's always pushing the boundaries by telling truth. And they're seeking, verse 30 says, they were seeking to seize him, and no man laid his hand on him. Why? Because his hour had not yet come. So this idea, like, they're trying to kill him, but it's not time. They can't. His hour hasn't come. And so John is building suspense in the gospel. Turn over to chapter 8, verse 20. Once again, it says that he's in the temple area. Verse 20 says, these words he spoke in the treasury. This is chapter 8, verse 20. As he taught in the temple, no one seized him because his hour had not yet come. So this is interesting because now we're probably into the last of the, well, we are in the last year of Jesus. So we're in the third year of his ministry. And now the hour has come. This is significant. The hour has come. For what? The Son of Man to be glorified. That is shocking also. Sometimes we read this and we don't have to think about how shocking this is. We're so used to it. Why is this shocking? I want you to think about that. Well, we're getting ready to see a bloody crucifixion. Right? A Messiah crucified? A Savior crucified? Somehow that's glorious? Do you see the irony there? But how does Jesus look at it? The hour's come for the Son of Man. Now, I believe, as many do, that the Son of Man language comes from Daniel chapter 7. Okay, so turn over to Daniel chapter 7. Might take you a minute. Turn to the table of contents if you need to. If you're a new believer or you've been a believer a long time, you're like, where's Daniel at? All right, it's on page 1420 of mine. But, all right, so anyway. So, in Daniel chapter 7, Daniel was a prophet. And Daniel's a very interesting book. Having these different dreams, these visions, interpretations. And not to get into the whole context of chapter 7, but many believe that this Son of Man language comes from Daniel 7, verse 13 and 14. I kept looking in the night visions, and behold, with the clouds of heaven, one like the Son of Man coming. And he came up to the Ancient of Days and was presented before him. And to him was given dominion, glory, and a kingdom, that all peoples, nations, and men of every language might serve him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion, which will not pass away, and his kingdom is one which will not be destroyed. You have these different kingdoms. You have the Son of Man. So, I believe, this isn't a, right? Jesus uses the Son of Man language, and he later, like in the Gospel of Matthew, this final week, Jesus uses the Son with great power and glory. There's only one place to find that kind of language, and it's right here. So, back to chapter 12. This, all right, so still, I want you to think about the question. The Son of Man being glorified, yet it is a bloody, rigged, if you will. They break all kinds of protocols, laws, the religious leaders do. They falsely charge him. All kinds of accusations, insult him, slap him, beat him. And if you remember, I've said, like last week, Jesus comes as a king. But here, this king is getting crucified. There's a lot of irony here, deep irony. Satan, as we see, remember when Jesus is going to have the supper, we'll see in chapter, the next chapter, where he's eating, and it says, Satan enters Judas. To what?
Betray the Son of Man.
Why would Satan be interested in betraying the Son of Man? Is it because he doesn't know the plan and is trying to thwart somehow? The Messiah comes on the scene. Spiritual activities increased, as we know in the gospel accounts, where Jesus is doing battle, spiritual battle. But we're going to see a reference to Satan tonight. But if you think about this narrative that's being shown from the beginning of the Bible to the end, you've got the king coming in, right? So in like John 1:10, although the world was made through him, the world did not yet know him. The world didn't recognize him. So the king of the universe comes in incognito, takes upon flesh, right? The eternal Son with the Father before the world began comes in incognito. He is a king. He's going to be asked by Pilate, "Are you a king?" And Jesus is like, "Yeah, you just said it." Well, wait, how is a king getting crucified? And this is brilliant. If you grab a hold of this, it's glorious, because here a king comes in and he could obliterate the whole scene, right? He could change everything. He's willingly submitting himself to that, and he's crucified. And yet he's getting ready to be crucified. Insults hurled at him, etc. Spit upon, mocked, crucified. So that these verses should shock us when we read this. When Jesus says, "The hour has come that the Son of Man would be glorified." He says, "Truly, truly," this is amen in the Greek. It's amen, amen. And just so nobody ever misinterprets it, what does amen be mean?
Let it be.
So let it be. Usually we say it at the end of a prayer. Jesus is saying it at the beginning. Truly, truly, so let it be. Usually he marks off some very important statements with this. "I say to you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains alone. But if it dies, it bears much fruit." What is he doing here? He's using an analogy. Got some wheat here tonight. I've had this in my office for years, and I thought, well, I'll use this for an illustration. So I picked off one of these little kernels, right? Very tiny. And I also have some packets of tomato seeds, very tiny seeds. Got some pea seeds, other kinds of seeds. But the point is what? You've got this dry little dead kernel. But just, right? What happens when it goes in the ground? This one little seed is going to produce this. We're getting ready. Some of us plant seeds indoors. I know there's probably a couple people watching on here that they grow a lot of their plants indoors. I'll start with a little. But tomato seeds are real tiny. This one little tiny seed produces a big plant that produces what?
Multiple.
A ton of fruit. So I want you to think about the vivid illustration that Jesus is using here. This little piece of grain is going to die and yet bring what? Life. Abundant life. A lot of life. I think what he's saying is, through my death comes spiritual prosperity. Children. Spiritual children are going to come from my death. People are going to benefit. A lot of people are going to benefit from this one death. And so he uses, all the way through his ministry, he uses shepherd language, agricultural language that they know very well, to communicate deep spiritual truths. Jesus was an excellent communicator and uses all these different ways to drive home these points. Now, in Isaiah, when I read this, I think of like Isaiah 53. Isaiah 53 is a prophecy 700 years before the Messiah, prophet Isaiah. And Isaiah talks about a suffering servant. And as you read Isaiah 53 sometime by yourself. I mean, just get along and just read the whole thing. He was pierced for our transgressions, verse 5, crushed for our iniquities, by his scourging. All this language of being killed, like a lamb being slaughtered, like a sheep silent before his shears. He didn't open his mouth. Verse 9, he's killed. Verse 9, his grave, speaking of his death, his grave was assigned with wicked men. He had done no violence. There wasn't any deceit. These are all quoted then in the New Testament referencing Jesus. Verse 10, the Lord was pleased to crush him, putting him to grief if he would render himself as a guilt offering. He will see his offspring. He will see his offspring. He will prolong his days. The good pleasure of the Lord will prosper in his hand. As a result of the anguish of his soul, he will see it be satisfied. By his knowledge, the righteous one, my servant, will justify the many. How? Well, he will bear their iniquities. So, here you have a suffering servant who is going to die on behalf of others. And it's the Lord's doing. But he will see his offspring. When I think of seeing his offspring, this is, I think Jesus, when he's talking about this little kernel, is going to produce a lot of offspring. My death is going to bring about spiritual life for many. So when you're getting ready to plant your seeds, these little dead seeds that have no life in them, they get buried, and God brings about abundant life, a lot more than just this one. So some pretty powerful stuff. Verse 25, another powerful statement. Back to John 12. He who loves his life loses it. And he who hates his life in the world will keep it to eternal life. If anyone serves me, he must follow me. And where I am, there my servant will also be. And if anyone serves me, the Father will honor him. So you have two paths. People who think there's no way I'm going to be a Christian and serve God, live for him, and live the way he wants me to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, died and rose again, and dedicate my life of living for him, following him. They love their life, they think. I want to live for these things. Well, guess what they're going to do? They're going to lose it. Now, he who hates his life in this world, now this is kind of ironic because you don't really hate your life, do you? But you do hate it in the sense that you say no to yourself to go live a life away from knowing God, being a rebel in God's world. God, I don't want it, like I did for 24 years. I don't care about who God is. I don't want anything to do with him. I really don't care about sin or anything else. How many people live that way?
Many.
I live, right? And guess what? They're going to lose their life, ultimately. They look at our life and they think, gosh, they're losing their life. No, we're actually gaining it. But we hate it in such a sense of what you think. We don't, like, there's a decisive day when you become a Christian where there's a break. I don't really care about what the world thinks of me anymore in that way. Right? I live by different standards. I have a different allegiance. King Jesus is Lord. When we say Jesus is Lord of our life, I'm now following him. So he's Savior and he's Lord. One of the memory verses that I've mentioned on Facebook many times, very captivating, is over in Luke chapter 9. Luke chapter 9, verse 23. So remember, these Greeks are coming to Jesus. They're coming into Jerusalem, and he's speaking to them, and Jesus did this often, like in Luke chapter 9. He was saying to them all, verse 23, if anyone wishes to come to after me, he must deny himself, take up his cross daily, and follow me. Stop right there. We're not looking for one time, oh, I'll trust in Jesus, go on my merry way. We're talking about come to Jesus, find sins forgiven, right? Come to know God, but you're now a lifelong disciple of Jesus. There's none of this, hey, I got my ticket punched. Now I'm on my merry way. The New Testament doesn't know anything like that. Listen to the word. We're still in Luke 9. For whoever wishes to save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake, he's the one who will save it. For what is a man profited if he gains a whole world and loses or forfeits his soul? What kind of a bargain? A lot of you are bargain hunters, right? You like a good bargain? What kind of bargain is it if you lose your soul? I've gained all this thing, all this stuff in this world, lived the life I wanted to live, thought it was all right. What kind of a bargain is that and then lose your soul? Other people look at it like, man, you're losing your life living, being a dedicated Christian. No, the tables will be turned. I'm actually saving my life in that sense. I love this. This is one of my favorite passages. Whoever's ashamed of me and my words, the Son of Man will be ashamed of him when he comes in his Father's glory. So Jesus says this stuff often in his ministry. Now this last week, you got some Greeks coming to him. Once again, he sets this out. Look, here's what it means to follow me. But look at the great promise, right? He is calling you to follow him. Wherever he is, that's where, right? And where I am, there my servant will also be. If anyone serves me, my Father will honor him. Pretty good stuff. Where's ultimate payday at? Where, salvation is all by grace. We're getting into heaven by the blood of Jesus. But this idea of well done, good and faithful servant. Right? Following Christ and until we meet him. Verse 27. Now my soul has become troubled. What shall I say? Father, save me from this hour? I mean, the hour has now come, right? My soul is troubled. Why would Jesus' soul be troubled? The weight of sin, right? Bearing the wrath of God that you deserve. All of that weight. I don't think we'll ever be able to reach the depths of stuff like this. Do you? Could we really understand the troubled soul of Jesus at this moment? So, very confident, the hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified, and yet my soul has become troubled. What shall I say? Should I say, Father, save me from this hour? I love this. Read it, Pammy. What's that last phrase?
But for this purpose, I came to this hour.
For this purpose. It reminds me of 1 Timothy 1:15. Paul, trustworthy statement deserving full acceptance that Christ Jesus came into the world to
save sinners.
Jesus is saying, this is the purpose. Should I say, Father, save me from this hour? No, how could I do that? That's why I came. As troubled as my soul is, I came for this very purpose. So think about it. Here you have a king who you've been a rebel in his world, and this king is going to die for you. I'll never forget, we were at a conference where we heard that song about the king dying. I just was moved to tears. I was thinking about how powerful that is, the imagery that a king would die for me. Hallelujah, I put on today. Hallelujah, what a savior. When you think about the redemptive drama that's going on here, and these words, right? My soul has become troubled, but should I say, Father, save me from this hour? No. It's the purpose I came. He's going to go through with it. Verse 28. Father, glorify your name. Honestly, folks, I believe chapter 12 on, we're going to see this inner Trinitarian work. I believe there's nothing like it in the New Testament. We're going to get this Trinitarian language from really here on out. We have throughout the Gospel of John, but it's going to be stepped up. I came from the Father, came into the world. I'm going back to the Father, going to send the Spirit. This Trinitarian language, like right now, who's he? What he's communicating? Father, glorify your name. We're going to see his high priestly prayer in John 17. Father, what? Restore to me the glory I had with you before the world was. That type of language. Now we hear something rare. Very rare. What do you call those boxes you guys have in your homes? We don't have one.
Alexio. Alexis.
Is it Alexis? Alexio? You guys know what I'm talking about. Does it ever come on like when you don't expect it? I've been at someone's home where... Well, the temperature is, or the population is, and if you happen to slip up and say Google or a phrase, it will just answer a question. And it's pretty cool because you can just like ask a question and very quickly it's giving you an answer. So you could like be walking around your house, all of a sudden probably, you know, a voice comes. But think about this. Jesus is here in Jerusalem and a voice is heard. I have glorified it and will glorify it again. I mean, can you imagine this? So, if you picture a house, see, some people live in a world where you just have one story. It's just this, what we see here. There's, you know, in the second story, like God can't intervene on the first floor. So some people, you know, oh, I might believe, you know, there's a God, but he, you know, can't break in to our realm, if you will. That's ridiculous, right? But this is unique, right? This is a supernatural event, a historical event, the most important redemptive event in all of history. And I would like to see this too. Can you imagine, wouldn't you like to have a video of this happening? Like people looking around and wondering what happened. Like if you just heard a voice. Now we live in an era that you've got speaker systems and all of this. Like when we were outside at church, remember when we met outside, guys, and we had that loud speaker system and somebody would be walking across the parking lot and every once in a while I'd go, Joe, go ahead and have a seat, Joe. You know, oh, it's Kindle, you know, because you're thinking, where's that source coming from? Well, take a look, verse 29. So the crowd of people who stood by and heard it were saying that it had, was that thunder? I mean, because evidently it is a loud voice that they evidently know. It's not just some Joe saying a few words. This is a loud, evidently, voice that you know something is very... Was that like thunder, but it sounded like a voice? So imagine this. Jesus is saying, Father, glorify your name. A voice out of heaven, out of the sky. I have glorified it and will glorify it again. The crowd of people stood by and heard it, were saying it thundered. Others were saying, is this some kind of angelic appearance? What's going on? And Jesus said, this voice has not come for my sake. I don't need it, but it's come for your sakes. How do you read that, Pammy? Put you on the spot. Do you ever think about this?
It's another sign.
It is another sign, isn't it? It's another sign. Like, what just happened there? Okay? At times, answered prayer. How in the world do you understand that? I mean, there's some crazy answers of prayers at times. There's events that you just sometimes just can't explain. It's a God thing. Here, it's really a God thing. And Jesus is like, look, guys, that wasn't for me. It was for you. How gracious is this for God? Even the signs that we see in Jesus' life here. But even once again, it's pretty cool. Jesus, verse 30, I'm glad we get this commentary. Verse 31, interesting verse. Judgment. Now judgment is upon the world, and the ruler of this world will be cast out. And if I'm lifted up from the earth, will draw all men to myself. He was saying this to indicate what kind of death by which he would die. Now, let's stop and go back. What do you think verse 31 means here? Now judgment is upon the world, and the ruler of this world will be cast out. There is some decisive thing that is happening with the death of Jesus. Here, Satan, no doubt, thinks he has the upper hand. But the death blow that Jesus brings, right, by his death and resurrection, he's coming to save. He's coming to set captives free. So if you were to look like in Acts chapter 26, verse 17 and 18, so if you're in John, let's just go over one book. 26. So Paul, who gets converted and a he's sharing his testimony on what God has called him to do, to rescue you from the Jewish people, from the Gentiles, whom I'm sending you. But here it is, verse 18. To open their eyes so that they may turn from darkness to light, from the dominion of Satan to God, that they may receive the forgiveness of sins and an inheritance among those who've been sanctified. How? By faith in me. So he's talking to King Agrippa. He's talking about his conversion. He's talking about what God has sent him to do. What's interesting is that people may turn from the kingdom of Satan to the kingdom of God and receive forgiveness of sins and inheritance, right? Of those who have been sanctified, set apart by faith in me. Paul saying that was my mission. So also we see this in, turn over to the right to the book of Colossians chapter 1. You see it there also, where Paul, these people have come to faith in Jesus, right? And verse 13 says, he's rescued us from the dominion of darkness and transferred us into the kingdom of his beloved Son, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. So it's like this, like Acts 26, verse 18. People may not realize it, but you're either in the kingdom of darkness or in the kingdom of God. There's only two kingdoms. Only two realms, only two types of people. Those who are redeemed, who know God, and those who are still in spiritual darkness. Do you ever wonder why some people, they just don't have any spiritual appetite at all for the things of God? They don't even want to talk to you about it. It shows the captivity of their soul. Now, can God change that radically? Can he pull them out of that? And so what does God use? He uses the gospel. So when Paul was being used of God, what is his message? Jesus and him crucified. What was his message everywhere he went? A crucified Messiah. A crucified and risen Savior. That's his message. Everywhere he went, crucified King, who was raised from the dead. That message, what? Sets people free. Pulls them out of the kingdom of darkness. I now have a new allegiance. So Jesus is, I believe, referencing just that. This judgment that is going to happen. Now we are able, so men and women around the world are set free from that darkness, transferred into the kingdom of the Lord Jesus. Verse 32. And if I'm lifted up from the earth, will draw all men to myself. Who's he speaking to? Greeks with other Jews around him. So with the message of Jesus, and what do we see in the book of Acts? Jewish people are coming to faith in Jesus, but people all around the world. Paul's desire was to share the gospel all around the world. And Jesus' words, his command was to make disciples of all the nations. And what we see in the book of Revelation, one of my favorite texts is Revelation chapter 5, where it speaks of in heaven is this great mosaic of people. I love to think about this all the time, that there are millions of Chinese people that know the Lord Jesus. Right? Remember that scientist we met or heard in Boston?
Yep.
Atheist, looking in her microscope. She shared her testimony at the end of a church service, PhD. She said, I came to the conclusion there has to be a God, but I didn't know who this God was. I knew he had to be powerful and intelligent and wise. And my science led me to this belief and came to America on a research paper. Now, listen, the Christian message is not American. It just happened to be she came here and ran into some Christians, right? We need to remember that. It started in the Middle East. There are Christians all over the world. But anyway, to finish the story, she then heard about Jesus and became a believer. What I love that there are millions of Chinese people, Indonesian people, people all around the world that have come to a saving relationship of Jesus. This was his goal. I'm lifted up. I'm going to draw all types of men and women scattered around the world to my. This has been the message of the New Testament for 2,000 years. So let's turn over. Let me turn over to Revelation chapter 5. It's why we send out missionaries. It's why our church raised funds to send out missionaries. 100% of Lottie Moon mission funds, Not only did we just raise $5,000 at Christmas, 100% of that goes to missions. Then throughout the year, we also send to an organization that sends out missionaries. Why? Because we want to be obedient to Jesus. Simply put. Why? Because people live in darkness need to hear the gospel. Right? And we're also called, though. We're called to share the good news of Jesus. And he's calling all types. Now, all right, so Revelation 5. This is a picture in heaven. Standing before the throne. It says they sing a new song.
Verse 9.
Worthy are you to take the book and break its seals. You were slain, purchased for God with your blood. What? What does it say, Pammy?
Men from every tribe and tongue and people and nation.
Redemption. All types of people. All types of backgrounds. You're worthy to take the book because you purchased this great mosaic of people. So, awesome that Jesus is saying this in John's gospel. This last week, these Greeks coming to him. Verse 33. But he was saying this to indicate the kind of death by which he was to die. So we'll stop there tonight. We have a king that's totally in control. The hour has come. He knows what's going on. He said, this is the purpose that I came. I'm going through with it. And I'm going to deliver a death blow. And I'm going to be delivering people out of the kingdom of Satan into the kingdom of God. And by my death, I'm going to bear much fruit. So when you plant seeds, you plant these little kernels, these little seeds. I want you to think about the death of Jesus. That one death has now created this great mosaic of people from every tribe, tongue, and nation. Isn't that a beautiful thought? That's why we're going to sing about his redemption, about what he's done. He's worthy. Why is he worthy? Why should we be worshiping Jesus, meeting with God's people? And by the way, when we take communion, what are we doing? Jesus said, do this in remembrance of me. This is the blood of the covenant. So we have a great king to serve, to love, to worship. And we get to read. Aren't you glad we get to read about his life, what he was like, what he said? So listen, friends. You want a good Bible reading plan? I hope you know the gospel well, the gospel accounts. How well do you know, like, the gospel of John? Get to know, listen, is Jesus the great, out of all, everybody in Scripture, is he the greatest one to know about his life, to be a student of Jesus, to learn about him? So maybe you don't have a Bible reading plan or something. Just take the Gospel of John. Take one of the Gospels, read it through, and understand Jesus' words in a context, and faithfully love them out and share them with others. So, well, we've got some time here tonight. It's good to see Helen and Judy and others on tonight. Any closing thoughts or questions you might have? Are you glad you know him? Are you glad you're no longer in that kingdom of darkness? Can you say tonight that you are a follower of Christ? You accept his death and resurrection. You believe he's the eternal Son of God that died on your behalf. I think of 2 Corinthians 5 where Paul said, we no longer live for ourselves, but we live for him who died and rose again on our behalf. Our life is centered on him. And that does mean what? Getting to know what his word says. And say, Jesus, you're my king. You're my Lord. I want to follow you for what you've done for me. Out of love, I want to serve you. Do that being a baker, right? You're making cookies at a local factory, or you're a banker, or you're a carpenter, or you're a truck driver. Wherever you're at, whatever walk of life, no matter where you're at in life, to be a Christian and to love Jesus and to follow him.
Question.
Yeah.
In verse 32, why did Jesus say if?
And I, if I'm lifted up, will draw all men to myself.
Why did he put an if?
If?
And I, if I'm lift up. Because he knew he was going to be. I think that's what the person's asking. Oh. He would have known.
Just a way of speaking. If I'm lifted up, not as if, you know, I don't know if I am or not, because he knows that I came for this very purpose, right? So, yeah, good thought, but hey, we know he follows through with
maybe
it.
Maybe he meant, and I because, can if sometimes mean because
I'm lifted up. I'll do a little research on it, but yeah. If I'm lifted up, and I am going to be. If I'm lifted up and I am going to be, I'm going to draw all men in myself. He knows, I mean, think about how many times in the life of Jesus did he say, we're going to Jerusalem, I'm going to be handed over, spit upon, mocked, crucified, and on the third day rise again. So throughout his ministry, he's predicting all of it. The arrest, details, beaten, crucified, third day raised again. So if it's true that I'm going to be lifted up from the earth, I'm going to draw all men to myself. But if I find out anything else on that this week, I'll go back and look at the Greek text and see if there's anything there that will help us out. I will let you know. Good question. Who said that?
Judy.
Judy? Okay. Yeah, I'll check that out, Judy. So let me ask you, I don't need to know what reading plan you are doing, but would you agree that knowing the life of Jesus out of all the Bible, right? I mean, all the Bible is profitable, right? All scripture is inspired by God and it's profitable, right? We can learn, but to not know about the life of Jesus, his statements, his words, what happened, I think it's kind of sad. I mean, he's the most important person in all the universe, all of history, most important event. So let's be good students of his word. That's why I'm glad you're on here tonight. We're not wasting our time by studying the most important person in all of history and all the universe to learn about who he is. Even if you don't believe in Jesus, at least, right, read the gospel accounts for yourself. John was an eyewitness, walked with Jesus for 3 years. This is what happened, and we call you to repent and to believe. And to not believe in Jesus is to rebel. Plain and simple. The message is there. We're declaring what happened. The king came into the world incognito, was crucified, rose again on our behalf. Brings redemption, forgiveness of sins. There's no forgiveness apart from him. Very clear throughout the New Testament. So we're proclaiming it. Right? That's what we proclaim. We proclaim good news. It's already happened. It's good news. What are you going to do with it? Then the rest of our life is wanting to grow more and who learning who he is, etc. And if I said tonight, how many of can look back at your life and say, yeah, I've grown spiritually. I've grown, but there was a decisive time where you went from the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of the Lord Jesus. This Sunday, we're going to be baptizing. What is baptism? It's people who are declaring they're now a part of this kingdom, and I'm doing that through baptism. So, this Sunday, now we can do baptisms anytime, so if you can't, if you're on tonight, you haven't been baptized, and you're a believer, if you haven't been baptized, you're being disobedient to King Jesus, who said to. So, get with me, okay? I'll put a plug in there. Well, anything else, Pammy?
That's all I see.
I think it's supposed to be nice tomorrow, so.
And then snow this weekend.
Snow this weekend? Okay. Let's pray. Lord, I give you thanks. Thank you, for the Gospel of John, how rich it is. Just help us, Lord, to, have compassion, for those around us who are still in the kingdom of darkness. We were there. I was there. May we realize what we were like and to have love and compassion and that we would share the good news of Jesus with people, being patient with them, praying for them, loving them. And we pray that what we're doing tonight will bear fruit, not just for those of us who know Jesus, learning more about his life, but we pray that we will see people come into the kingdom to experience the forgiveness of sins and the joy of knowing you. Or maybe even tonight, in the quietness of someone's home. I know with me, it's 12 o'clock at midnight beside my bed, where I recognized that I was a sinner in need of saving, February of 1989. And we pray that maybe even tonight, somebody will look back, saying that this was the night in which they came to know you. So we pray for this in Christ's name. Amen. Amen. Have a good night and good rest of the week. We will finish, well, we'll pick it up next week.